is quite an emotional moment for all of us who own family as a great teacher, as a great scholar, as a great anthropologist, but more as a great friend, a really warm and sensitive friend to whom all of us owe a lot. I entered the university in 1957 and joined the Department of Sociology, as I said, a very small Department of Sociology in 1958. That was the year that Ghana came in as a lecturer in the Department of Sociology. So we are thinking of a period of over 50 years where we have maintained a very affectionate relationship. And so the talk of Tambi brings many memories. Of course, sociology was not a very popular subject at that time. Right? We had been hived off from economics, which was promoted as a sure way of getting a job. Sociology didn't have that promise. It is also largely because many of the undergraduates, particularly the girls, had read Margaret Mead about sex and savages. So there was a general feeling that all those who were in the sociology department were more than usually interested, I don't know about savages, but at least about sex. It was a wonderful department. Our professor was, we had really had only three lecturers. We had Professor Ralph Peeris, then we had Tambiah, and Lanka.
That's in the 60s.
But when we came in, we had only these three. But we would opt to do some, we really did only five subjects arriving, sociology. Three others were optional subjects, like Ceylon history, which we did that time. Arasaratnam and Karl Rohrer, who were their top class teachers, and also economics with Hilary Woodson. So it was a very fruitful exercise and really, I would say, an outstanding 4 years in the university, which could be compared, looking back now 50 years, with the best sort of education you can get anywhere in the world. We had a wonderful faculty, wonderful set of students, a wonderful library. I think it was a dream come true. And looking at some of the things that we discussed today, let me first clear one misconception. That is this thing about Buddhism betrayal, because I myself was somewhat responsible for this. Because it's not the question mark. Actually, before that, in the 50s, there was a book, there were two books. One was called The Revolt in the Temple. The other one was called Buddhism Betrayal, which introduced the, what I would call the SLFP complex, just before 1956, into popular discussion. And I drew Tambi's attention because it was not a very well-known book, as I did draw his attention, because I stayed, as John remembers, I was in Harvard with him for 6 months. I lived with him for some time. And we often used to discuss these matters. And even Reverend Walpole Rahula's writings and the Fish Shrift, we discussed very often. So Tambi was au fait with some of these, you know, revolt in the temple, Buddhism betrayed, some of those sort of markers of the revival. And I think it was in that ironic sense that he used the title of Buddhism betrayed with a question mark. So it is only when you understand that that he was really analyzing what happened in 56 and even before that type of mentality, then the title becomes meaningful. But it was misunderstood, and that was why there was this controversy. But to get back to Tambi, really, what is crucial for him, when you look at his development, and which he refers to also, because in this book called Leech, he has a little, maybe, is that so good, 7 or 8 pages about his own career. And that book. So, as a budding sociologist, actually not really a socialist, came back from Cornell, he first did a study of Marada, what we call the Vattas in Marada, which helps me very much politically because I can always draw on his insights about what happens in Colombo Central. Most politicians are quite surprised that I know all this. Because Tambi goes into all those details about the wells there, how they rent, you know, how you have to pay 10 cents to get people to draw water for you, all sorts of material. But the key publication was what he called the disintegrating village. He and Sarka of the statistics department. They brought out the paper on somewhere near Dumbal, Patadumbal, disintegrating village. Now this came at a very important time and it brought Tambi into contact with two key figures, which I should mention, in the world of, and one was Leech, other one was Dumo. Other one was Dumo. And I mean, Leech and Dumo were really at the top of the pile, as far as anthropology was concerned. And this work came in at a time when the anthropological world was being moved around, as Gandhar said, typified by the intellectual controversies of Mayor Fortes and Leech, the Africanists, particularly Radcliffe Brown, Nevels Pritchard, and everybody, had emphasized lineage. The tribe was the society. The tribe was the state, in certain cases. So the notion of an intensive study of the tribe or that society gave so many insights to that changing African scenario. Whether it's the Noor, the Talensi, all those studies. In the first wave, as it were, of social anthropology became the idiom of social anthropology, British social anthropology, but was now, just when Tambi's papers were coming out, being challenged by two. One by Leech and one by Dumo. Leech was very interesting. He took this, the religion of British animals, the idea of kinship, the idea of genealogies, ideology of kinship as the juridical principle of organizing those African tribes and challenged it. He challenged it in Sri Lanka, in his study of Puleli, the village in North Central Province, which I visited recently. And there are he came up with the proposition that there's no such thing as kinship. Kinship is meaningless. What matters is land tenure. What matters is ad hoc arrangements. You might be surprised, but I'll read to you what Leech wrote. He talks about, this is Adam Cooper, anthropologist. And there, after dealing with May 4th AC, he says, to this leech opposed the view that at least this one village in the dry zone of Ceylon was ordered above all by material factors. It was locality rather than descent which forms the basis of corporate groupings. Indeed, to quote Leach, the group itself need have no rules. It may be simply a collection of individuals who derive their livelihood from a piece of territory laid out in a particular way. The continuing entity is not only a society, but only itself, the village tag, the Gangode area, the old field. So this was a frontal attack on the traditional descent-based, kinship-based social anthropology background, which was prevalent at that time. And coincidentally, Tambiah and Sarkar's study came out. So I'll take that theme up later. But also it came right into the debate of kinship itself that Luke Dumont had launched with his study in South India, just across in Ramna, where he did a study of the Peradeniya Kallar community, which is very much like the Sri Lankan or the Sinhalese form of kinship, where there was alliance. It was not genealogy that mattered, but alliance. That is, women takers and women givers, the two groups. And the Sri Lankan kinship terminology was a clear emphasis on that, because you have your mother's brother, he's not Aya or Malli, but Masina or Nair. Similarly, your father's sister's daughter is also Masina or Nair, whereas your own, your father's brother's daughter is Akka or Nair. So this is a classical, shall I say, formulation of the alliance theory. And embedded in Tambi's writing and Sarkar's writing was this exemplification, as it were, of the alliance theory, though he didn't call it alliance at that time. And there's an article by Dumont who says, and really it's in a way funny, that both Leach and Dumont say that this is a very good piece of research, but he came to it by instinct, not by studying the theory. But Tambiah has somehow sort of meandered into this type of thinking, which is crucial both for Dumont and Leach. I think that was the beginning of I think Tambiah refers to this in his book, where Leach had come on a second visit to Sri Lanka to check out some information on Puleli and met Tambiah at Peradeniya. Tambiah had shown him this paper, and then that relationship had started. And of course, that was a very great relationship. You read this book, you can feel the type of affection and love almost for Leach. That's a beautiful phrase by Mimologist Galna.
Yeah, very.
Where which we can attribute to Tambiah also. He says, Leach speaks, you can introduce Tambiah for that instead of Leach. Leach speaks, writes, and narrates, but these representations are filtered, selected, arranged, and mediated by my own activity, as Gavnath has been shown here, as narrator, commentator, and friend. Throughout much of this text, I am in dialogue with Leach, who cannot speak back now. So there is a sort of poignancy in this. And so I want to emphasize the centrality of that research, which was done in Pathadumbra. Then this led to another crisis in anthropology. It was, as Gandhi said, all these village studies, which were being done in Asia, whether it's mostly in India after Srinivas, the coups, you found the sense of dissatisfaction. You don't cover the whole picture by intensively studying a village. Because a lot of the concepts, a lot of the linkages are beyond the confines of the village. Be it religion, be it kinship, be it land tenural arrangements, be it polyandry, the African type of defining the village or tribal area does not give the whole answer as far as Asia is concerned. Why not? Because these are all embedded in a wider civilization. And in Sri Lanka and Thailand, it's a Buddhist civilization. So having started with the village studies, you had to go to a different type of anthropology, which looks at ideologies, looks at philosophies, religions, which go way beyond the village that he studied. And I think Tambi himself, who went to Thailand in 1960, I have a letter from him asking me to come as his research assistant in Thailand, which I treasure. And he himself, he first went there with UNESCO to do something, some studies about health or something like that, just to write a couple of reports. But then he found that to write that report, he had to get into the nature of the village, and village, from the village to the type of civilization in which that village was embedded. So we have all these great works that, three books, basically, about Thai Buddhism. I think the key corrective there to all Buddhist studies is the historical depth. He studies contemporary Thai society in terms of the very, very rich Buddhist textual tradition and the idea of medieval and pre-colonial linkages in the Buddhist world. For example, his study of the Jain Buddha. It originates in Sri Lanka, goes to Chiang Mai, then goes to Cambodia. People fight over it, then it comes to back to Bangkok and all that. So the idea of the galactic polity, which we can even use in South Asia or even Sri Lankan history, because you have all these little kingdoms linked by religion, but periodically one or two of those societies begin to flower, begin to dominate. So that is the sort of pulsating society for the time. But then that declines and some other part of the galactic polity emerges. So it's a very dynamic and fluid situation. And you cannot understand the Buddhism of one country unless you see that whole dynamism that is moving around in the Buddhist world. This is a great type of analysis that John says. I think it tries to bring history very much into the picture in analyzing that contemporary Buddhist society. Now, this becomes very, very important because on one side, you not only see the spread of this galactic polity, which gives us a different insight into what Buddhism was. I think Tambi was coming to that in the sense that in the pre-colonial world, whether it is Thailand, Sri Lanka, Cambodia, particularly in the Theravada world, there was so much apartheid. Revivals in one country affect revivalism in another. Kings of Thailand support the Buddhist revival. King Chulalongkorn came to Sri Lanka and had a hell of a row in the temple of the tooth because the Devadilu, who had given this to the Tsar of Russia, everybody to hold in his hand, refused that to Chulalongkorn, who was the most important man of that period and who was now trying to develop the idea of Thai kingship as a way of political unity also, giving the ultimate insight. And lots of things followed from that. But this was a sort of, you cannot talk of single Buddhism or Thai Buddhism or Cambodian Buddhism or Laotian Buddhism, unless just as you see the syncretism in your own country, you see this huge relationship and the galactic quality. So syncretism, which it studies in northern Thailand, and the galactic quality that he studies in the second book are interrelated. So this is a tremendous contribution to the study not only of Thailand, but also the study of Buddhism in a dynamic way. There are criticisms of course. This is in a way an ironic criticism, because most of the Thai writers have been interested in this. They are saying, look at Tambiah. He is not quoting a single Thai word. He is quoting the Mahavamsa, he is quoting the Janakalwani, all these Sinhalese Buddhist texts in trying to understand Thai Buddhism. Of course, given the fact that there is this interplay, yes, that could be done. But the emerging criticism of his work is that, and this is something which is very ironic given the fact that he was accused of all these things, that he is actually looking through Sri Lankan Buddhist eyes into Thai Buddhism. And that this is sometimes pointed out by the Thai scholars that this is a defect. So this is the type of relationship that we have to study. He made a huge contribution in that. As John said, Tambi's studies on ethnic conflict in Sri Lanka is only a small part of his work. And the most significant aspect of that, which he himself admits, is that he does it entirely on secondary sources. Is that so?
Yes.
Entirely on secondary sources. And I would say, rather, you have to evaluate the usefulness of these sources. For Western scholars, it's very difficult to distinguish between some newspaper article somewhere or some reporting of a political meeting somewhere. Very much of these writings, of Shawl, of Tambiah, of all these Western people who have written about ethnic conflict in Sri Lanka, they cannot distinguish between what is the most significant elements of it and what are ephemeral elements. They will say, the island has written this somewhere on the 18th or the 20th, the Daily News write something, and then take it as the equivalent of some big report. You know, the whole idea of putting it in perspective, I think, is greatly deficient in many of those writings. I'm not saying that Tambi's writings was an example of that, but he depended very much on secondary sources, and this has been clearly mentioned. And in my view, none of those writers have been able to distinguish, or shall I say, to evaluate the value of these contributions. You should begin with that, because all the information that is coming in through newspapers, media, and so on, all don't have the same import, the same values to look at the total picture. Then finally, I must say, because I was with Tambi, I lived in his house also, and John, I must say, I must thank John. He looked after me very well there. He will remember, and he has also mentioned in that, Tambi's vision for Sri Lanka was not one of separatism or one of conflict. That's why he used the word fratricidal conflict. And he used to tell me, I don't know if he was mentioning, that all his properties in his father was, you know, the crown proctor of Jaffna. And he had extensive properties, or he inherited. All that was taken over by the LGT. So he said, I can't even go back to Jaffna, all my open lands have been taken over by the LGT. I don't think that's why he suggested that there should be no separatism. But the fact is that he always had a vision that we could all come together. And in this book, or in some other book, in the Leveling Grounds, he has a very warm passage where he says that when they were studying in 1956, I believe, doing some research in Galloway, that there was some communal riots, and students, all ensured that he didn't have even any bad feelings about the matter, and hence this is the type of Sri Lanka that we thought and we had at Peradeniya in that time. I think I'm right in correcting that. So that's the vision that we had. So I thought I must do something different. I, as a Buddhist and as a person who knows the Buddhist tradition, and as a great friend of Tambi, I want to recite some of the Buddhist prayers for the day. This is only fair. I don't want to, I will not sing it loud or intone it like the monks, but this is something that is that I think is good in, because these are the funeral ceremonies, the verses. I think we'll all get some time, but for obvious reasons we will not hear. So one is Anichavata Sankara Uppada Vayadamiko Uppajitva Nirujanti Desan Upa Samosi, which means Anichavata Sankara. All elements are transient. Uppada Vayadamiko. It is a rule that applies to everyone. Uppajitva Nirujanti. All those who are born will die. Desam chupa samosuko. So the only peace, samosuko, the sense of bliss can only come if you are not born and if you do not die. And then there is this beautiful poetic passage which I want to read to you, where I think we can all join in transferring merit to Tambi. It says, Yatavari Vahapura Paripurendi Sagara Eva Meva Ito Dinna Pedana Upakapta. Yatajari Vahapura Paripurendi Sagara. That is when they have the act of pouring the water, which means just as the raindrops fall and they all come together to make one big jalasi or gathering of water, reservoir, may all our good thoughts, each one's thoughts for this person, as they drop from heaven, as it were, the rain, let it gather together and bring merit to this person. Then there's another one. Unna me udakam vantam yata tiranam pavattati eva meva itto dinnam petanam upakam. Just as the water flows down from high points to a vast concourse of water, may all our thoughts like that, like those drops of water, gather to bring merit to our dear friend. Thank you very much. Thank you.